When the current does flow and that makes the motor go, that's a relay.
Got one of our relays from Mauser. Just want to demonstrate how much packaging there is. A bag, take this out of the bag. And what do we have in the bag? We have another bag. Inside the bag, we have a box. Let's open the box. Inside the box, bubble wrap. What's in the bubble wrap? More bubble wrap. Let's see what's in there. It's a bag. Inside the bag, we have a relay. Our relays for the charging interlock are actually transparent. So that's going to be pretty cool because we can actually see it electromechanically actuate whenever we plug it in. At least until we put it in the car, and then we're never going to see it again. You can see there's a spring on top, and there's sort of like a round cylinder thing. That's the electromagnetic coil. So whenever the relay energizes, it pulls this to the left. Take it back now, y'all. There's these two rows of three little contacts there. So those are what actually get switched back and forth whenever you energize the relay. So if we just plug this into the wall, theoretically, you'd be able to see that click back and forth.
What's the deal with relays? This simple circuit has a power source and a load and a path for electrical current. Current flows through a wire from the positive terminal of the power source, powering the load, and back through another wire into the negative terminal of the power source. If we add a switch to this circuit, we can control the flow of current by physically manipulating the switch. When our switch is open, it breaks the circuit because no current can flow through its terminals. When we operate the switch, we move the contact into its closed position and complete the circuit once more. This switch is called a single-pole, single-throw switch. The number of poles refers to the current paths it controls, and the number of throws refers to the possible number of paths those poles can take when the switch is manipulated. A relay works much like a switch in that it provides a way to control the flow of current. It also has a movable contact. It can be thought of as a switch which is operated by electricity. Relays come in many configurations, but for the sake of simplicity, in this example, our single-pole, single-throw relay has two normally open terminals. Normally open refers to the fact that without energizing the relay, these terminals are open, meaning the circuit is incomplete. Aside from those terminals, a relay has coil terminals. These are connected to an electromagnetic coil. When we energize the coil, its electromagnetic field manipulates an armature that closes the movable contact between the relay's normally open terminals. These terminals close, and the circuit completes. Because the coil circuit is separate from the load circuit, we can energize the relay using a secondary power source, often of a different voltage than the one used in the load circuit. Once energized, a relay requires minimal current through the coil to maintain the field that keeps the contacts closed. Now let's introduce a new relay type, the single-pole double-throw relay. Note that this relay has a normally closed terminal as well as a normally open terminal. When the coil is not energized, the normally closed terminal will carry current. And if we apply power to the coil, current is redirected to the normally open terminal. Contactors work much the same way as relays, but they are typically designed for high voltage and or high current circuits and have physically larger contacts as a result. Like switches and relays, they come in a variety of pole and throw configurations. A contactor has a few specifications which are important to consider. One is its rated coil voltage, which is how many volts are required to energize the coil and move the contact. Another is the switching or contact voltage, which is the maximum voltage of the circuit that the contactor opens or closes. Lastly, there is the switching or contact current, which refers to how many amps the contactor's contacts can safely carry. These specifications are especially significant because if you exceed the switching voltage or current, the contactor could get damaged or fail to switch reliably. In the worst case, its contacts could become so hot that they fuse together and no longer move, leaving a normally open circuit closed even when the coil is de-energized. This is something we want to avoid. Contactors will have an important application in our charging circuit. Our onboard charger will accept an AC power input and convert it into a DC output, which recharges our battery pack. Because we'll want the ability to accept either 110 volts from a standard wall outlet or 220 volts from an EV charging station via our J1772 inlet, we will have two AC inputs wired into the charger. If we were to wire both these inputs directly into the charger, this would pose a safety risk because plugging in a 220 volt power source would energize the unused 110 volt charger cable with 220 volts. Likewise, plugging a 110 volt power source would energize the J1772 inlet. Both of these situations carry the risk of electrocution or severe equipment damage if someone were to touch the wrong thing or plug in both power sources by mistake. Fortunately, with the help of some plans we found on modularevpower.com, we can solve this problem and eliminate the hazard by using contactors to form an interlock. For one half of the interlock, we'll need a three-pole contactor with 110 volt AC coil voltage. This contactor will have two normally open poles and one normally closed pole. We'll connect our 110 volt inputs to the normally open inputs of this contactor. We'll also connect one of the inputs to one side of the coil. We'll wire the normally open outputs to the AC inputs of the charger. Note that the other side of the coil isn't connected to anything yet. For the other half of the interlock, we'll have a contactor with 220 volts AC coil voltage. It will have the same inputs and outputs, just with a higher rated switching current. As with the 110 volt side, we'll wire the 220 volt inputs to the contactor's normally open inputs and to one leg of the coil, and we'll wire the normally open outputs to the AC inputs of the charger. Again, the coil is only halfway connected. When one contactor is energized, we want to break the coil circuit of the other contactor. To accomplish this, we'll use the normally closed contacts of the 220 volt contactor to connect the other side of our 110 volt coil. With this setup, the 110 volt contactor can only energize if the 220 volt contact is not already energized. And likewise, we'll use the 110 volt contactor's normally closed contact to connect to the other side of the 220 volt coil, so the 220 volt contactor can only energize if the 110 volt contactor is not already energized. If all this seems complicated, don't worry, we worked it out. We're big brain geniuses building an EV. Let's look at what happens within this circuit when we charge. Let's say we plug into the 110 volt AC. Current flows through the normally closed contacts of the 220 volt contactor, energizing the 110 volt coil. The normally open contacts close and the charger receives 110 volt AC. No current can flow to or from the J1772 inlet. Now let's say we unplug from 110 volt AC, drive to an EV charging station, and connect the J1772 inlet. Current flows through the normally closed contacts of the 110 volt contactor, energizing the 220 volt coil. The normally open contacts close and the charger receives 220 volts AC. No current can flow to or from the male 110 volt plug. In conclusion, relays are a land of contacts.